Welcome to Oregon Voters Digest, the program that brings forward the social and political issues that are important to people living here in the Pacific Northwest. And now, your host, Bruce Broussard.
I'm in the chair, folks. I am in the chair. Thanks again for being here with us with the Oregon Voters Digest. I'm Bruce Broussard, your host. And we're going to have quite a show today. I realize that the sun is shining out there, and probably the majority of you out there enjoying that sun. And I hear you. But if some of you can just stick around for a bit, I think you're going to really enjoy this particular show. I had the opportunity to meet a couple of people when I went to City Hall one day and basically just kind of basically support this medium, which was a community medium. And all of a sudden, there I was. And then all of a sudden, I'm looking at a scene where folks are trying to talk to the commissioners, and the next thing I know, I don't have the opportunity. They don't have the opportunity. And so, wow. And as a result of that, I basically approached some of the individuals who had issues, and I just happened to have two of them there sitting here with me today. And we're going to talk about, in all due respect, as you know, I ran for mayor for the city of Portland, and those are some of the concerns. I had issues when I was running for the city of Portland, for the mayorship aspect of it. And so now, we've elected someone as mayor of the city of Portland. His name was Ted Wheeler. And now I'm saying, wow, what happened to this guy? Because in all due respect, all during the time of the campaign, I called this guy repeatedly, but he never would return his calls. And now I'm just a layperson aspect of it. I'm a talk show host here. I've been doing this stuff for about 25 years. And this show is all about one thing, is to educate and inform the public. And I think that's a good format. Aspect of it. But now I'm saying we have to do something about it, because in all due respect, what I'm seeing now, I've called the mayor. We just recently elected a newly a person at City Hall. The name is Hugh Daly, in all due respect, and she's a new city council person. And in all due respect, I supported her and a number of other people. So the whole idea was to get someone that could go behind the scenes or sit down and be a part and parcel of the elected group, right? But in all due respect, I'm calling her and I can't get her to respond to me. Mm-hmm. So my point is that, and this is not to be an anti-everything, we just need to understand what are the various relationships that we as citizens have in regards to issues that are of concern, that have come to concern, because that's why we voted. That's why we vote in this system. It's supposed to be a government of the people, by the people, and for the people. And so this show, and I've got two guests here that as far as I'm concerned, they're major proponents of that piece, because they have the courage and the guts, if you will, to go right before and discuss their issues. But what about the majority of us? The majority of the people don't have access. Even having those meetings on Wednesday morning at 9 o'clock on workday, as opposed to maybe having them on weekends and spreading it around the city aspect of it so people have access. I know they're talking about, well, we got it on OPB, we got it on channels and this, that, and the other. But hey, some people don't have radios. A lot of people don't have computers. No, a lot of people can't afford Comcast. Mm-hmm. I mean, so we got to do something, and we had to talk about this piece. And so hopefully, out of this discussion that I have with these two individuals, that's what we're going to be talking about. We're going to be talking about access, but the issues. It's about the issues of our livability in the city of Portland. And we need to know, how do we get that issue to the table? And those elected officials are supposed to be our representative after they've listened to what we had to say. Because it's not for them, if you will, to say, well, I got all the answers, and you just go home and whatever I give you. No, it's a government of the people, by the people, and for the people. And that's what we're going to talk about today. I've said enough, and let's get it right on. Joe, how you doing today?
I'm doing pretty good.
Yeah, that's my old, I call him my old, my Navy sidekick aspect of it. That was a department of the Department of the Marine Corps, was that there, Joe?
Well,
I don't want to get caught. Well, I know we got another show, but I'm going to slip that by. I'll slip that by.
We used to get you there. and then we went out and we ate hot food.
Oh, is that right?
Yes.
But you got me there.
Navy always has hot food.
Hot food.
Yes.
And you gave me the rations.
Yeah, we said goodbye to you guys.
Oh, gee whiz. Well, Nick, I better.
Bye-bye.
On that note, I better get over here. Mimi? Mimi.
Mimi.
Mimi. Mimi. Mimi German.
German. You're so
German.
Close.
Boy, that's
yeah,
it's almost like
years,
Broussard.
It's been German.
It's almost like Broussard. They call me Buzzard sometimes. So, yeah. So I've adopted the word Bruce. It's okay. Mm-hmm. But anyway, I got Mimi. And both of these individuals are, I mean, really, you guys are, I mean, I when I saw the action and whatever, I said, we have to do something about this piece. You see? So welcome to the show.
Thank both you.
And right
Thank
before that, I'm going to give it to you beforehand, because I've already had it, and they'll understand it. I'm going to give you something that I've been passing out for years. Enthusiasm.
Enthusiasm.
And it's a good one.
I like
and,
that.
And Joe mentioned the one about transparency, so we're going to create another
one. Yeah, we need
okay?
that one. We got to create that one bad. Again.
So look,
enthusiasm.
Look here, we got an hour to talk. This is not 3 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
I'm very familiar with the format that they have at City Council when you want to bring your issues up to the table. The 3 minutes, and how can you get 3 minutes?
Yeah.
You know, by the time you sit down and get your thoughts and whatever, you're not a professional politician. The layperson. In fact, you are more professional than the folks that are not there every day.
I think others beg to differ.
They're scared. They don't even want to be there. So this is not about, in all due respect, it's activism, but in all due respect, it's about voting. I mean, you're just like anyone else. You're a resident,
yeah.
And you've got concerns. And I'm very familiar with Joe, the renting issue aspect of it, the homeless issue aspect mm-hmm. of it, and all due respect, police is an issue aspect of it. I've always felt very strong that in all due respect, the mayor is the chief of police, so to speak. In many ways, but we got a problem there. We don't know who's running the city or not, you know.
Yes.
And so we got some things to talk about. So well, I think we got something. That's the format. So folks, so sit down here with us and bear with us. We're going to go through the full hour. If we don't have enough time this show, we'll do another show. We'll do it next week. Okay?
That would be good.
Okay. So let's start off by saying, what's your expectation once you've cast a vote about an issue? What's your expectation of once that person is elected? What's the flow of the issue at that point in time? I'll start off with you, Lynn.
Well, I think first of all, it starts with what they say they're going to do.
Okay.
You know, and if you vote for somebody who says they're going to do those things, then that person is required to do those things.
Okay.
But we know politics, and it rarely turns out that way.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't mean that I don't expect it, especially on a local level, where I can access them
mm-hmm.
by showing up
mm-hmm.
And making access happen in any way, shape, or form.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's local, I expect them to do what they say they're going to do, even though I have to say, I rarely ever, if ever, believe that they're going to do what they say
mm-hmm.
they're going to do.
Mm-hmm. And what about that format that's set up now? We're going to use the city of Portland because that's the one let's react
yeah.
to because that's basically where most of the viewership is. And the format that they have with the city of Portland at this point in time, does it work in regards to what you just shared?
No.
Okay, why?
Because politicians and their offices say that things should happen within a certain protocol, and that protocol's been set up. So for instance, I know first I'm supposed to go, if I have an issue with the mayor, I'm going to go call his office, see if they answer.
Right.
If they answer, I'm going to talk to whoever it is and find out who that person is
mm-hmm.
and see if my concern is met with the mayor.
Mm-hmm.
I can make a request that I'd like someone from the office to call me back,
mm-hmm.
see if that happens.
Mm-hmm.
I've done all this, by the way. And
did they respond?
Not for a while. So I follow protocol so that I can always say, like right now, I have followed the city's protocol. For me, it's more like a social science aspect of it. I follow it to see how it doesn't work
mm-hmm.
and to see if I'm right.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm right. You don't get a call back timely, if at all. And depending, and I have to say this, depending on your race, also depends if you're going to get a
really?
Call. Yeah.
I
have found this out through many friends in the black community that they do not receive phone calls back. So we follow the protocol, and then if we don't get heard and if our issue isn't being heard, you can sign up at the auditor's office to say your piece at city council, which will give you 3 minutes before city council on Wednesday mornings to speak your piece. They are not required to even respond. They can just say at the end of your 3 minutes, thank you. And then your issue is at least on the record, on the city record.
Mm-hmm.
But again, there is no requirement for them to respond to it.
So they don't respond, even though it's on the record.
They may not, but there's no requirement for them to respond.
Mm-hmm.
So you're just there now. You have now accessed the city
mm-hmm.
because you've done the protocol and you have given your 3 minutes
mm-hmm.
and you've said your piece.
Mm-hmm.
But what good does that do you? Okay, now you've been heard. Now what happens? And this is the largest flaw.
Okay.
Nothing.
Okay, Joe, what do you think? What's your feel?
Well, I agree with the presentation is that well, people see us sometimes really angry at City Hall. What people don't see is what we just talked about, is all of the work that happened beforehand, all of the phone calls, all of the trying to get the city council to respond to something. I'll give you an example. When we had the freezing, okay, We had people out in the streets using their own cars, mm-hmm. using their own food, using their own blankets, trying to help the homeless that were really trapped.
Okay.
Because the homeless do not want to leave their tents because they're afraid they're going to lose them, and they do mm-hmm. all the time. Mm-hmm. The city takes them. Mm-hmm. So if they leave them, cops come in and they take them. When you have that kind of an issue and you go before city council, what do you do with that? Do you come up to the city councilman and say, look, I would like to speak to you about, you have to do something about this?
Mm-hmm.
All right? And they say, no, you have to sign off for communications, mm-hmm. which may take 6 weeks.
That's the 3 minutes that
we That's the that 3 minutes about. That we all talk about. You can also speak on individual items. But if the item is not associated with what you are trying to tell them,
mm-hmm.
they will call you out of order. And I've been called out of order lots of times, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. Because the mayor does not want to hear somebody dying on the street. And we have people dying on the street, and they're upset because we disrupt their meeting. Balance that out.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Disruption, death.
Well, that's the...
You can't balance that out.
And that's the end of the line. That's after all of these other things had been tried and applied. And I know that from me because I was the person on day two who went to the mayor's office and wrote a list of what he could do to fix this and alleviate...
You gave him a solution.
I gave him a solution.
You gave him a solution.
And I got a call back about the solution, I think, 10 days after that. 10 days. There were already people dying on the streets.
Mm.
And then following the first few people who died on the streets, a baby died from his mother who was living on the streets.
Mm-hmm.
So she was pregnant. Homeless. She was homeless. She had her baby outside in the freezing cold and snow.
Mm.
And so there's so much to talk about. So what happened was I was seeing that Ted was not doing anything from the list that I had given him. Had he done what was on the list, and I'll just tell you what was on the list.
Yeah.
On the list was, Ted, go on TV and tell everybody in the community that we're all going
to
come together right now.
To help this issue.
And when you see people out there in your neighborhoods that are on the street, okay, let them know that we'll be sending our fleet of vehicles that say the city that works, we all know those vehicles, right?
Right.
We're going to be sending those out and we're going to be looking for them and we're going to ask them, if you'd like to come to shelter, we're going to bring you to shelters mm-hmm. because I, Ted Wheeler, am going to open every single shelter that mm-hmm. can possibly mm-hmm. be open mm-hmm. in this city, including every single community center in every single community mm-hmm. because as far as I know, there are many community centers. That wouldn't solve everything, but that right. would be a good start.
Mm-hmm.
To ask all of the churches, open your doors mm-hmm. right now. People are freezing to death, mm-hmm. you know? This was all on my thing. And when you go to pick people up with the city vehicles, also pick up their belongings because no one's going to leave their belongings
right,
behind.
Right.
And if you do that, we will start saving people. This is the humane thing to do. Nothing happened. I got a call from his office saying, these are all nice ideas.
Oh, yeah, they just this was, love our ideas.
And that's what they said. And I said, I don't care what you think of them. If they're not applied,
mm-hmm.
people are going to continue to die.
Right.
So people, the city wasn't doing anything. Ted opened one building. And his staff told me to go to another person. Is it Mark?
Mark. Joplin or
anyway,
Jolin.
No.
Home for everybody.
He's
in charge of that.
A nonprofit.
Yeah. So, yes. So, nothing was being done. I looked at what Ted did as actually unsafe and dangerous. What he had done was open one room in one building and said to everybody, to speaking as if he were speaking to the homeless people who couldn't hear him because they don't have TVs. Come to the Portland building and we'll take care of you. There's over 5,000 people on the streets, and that's a low estimate, right?
You're
gonna have, what if 5,000 people
right,
and How were those people who didn't know that Ted was saying this to the city going to get there, when he told the rest of us, stay off the streets, it's dangerous to be out there, we only want emergency vehicles out there as much as possible? Wow. And the other thing I suggested to him was that he put a call out to the community, mm-hmm. that if you have a vehicle that can handle the ice and snow, mm-hmm. it is a truck, mm-hmm. we need you to help pick up people off the street and bring them to shelters. But again, there was one shelter. The capacity hit on that shelter, one room. People had pneumonia, people had bronchitis, people were sick, they had colds, people were freezing, and they had all their belongings. One room. Would you go? Would you be in one room with all those people?
No,
this was
no,
like Katrina
no,
to me. Yeah, this is what happened. This was the president's response to Katrina. Yeah, throw them all in one room.
That's a good analogy.
And it really felt like that to me. And my anger with his lack of doing, mm-hmm. and telling the city, look at me, and he did this. I'm Ted Wheeler. I opened up a shelter. He was proud of that.
One room.
His disconnection between what he had done, the lack of safety for that, mm-hmm. for the people there, mm-hmm. and the lack of humanity mm-hmm. that he expressed as he was being narcissistic, telling the city, look at me, I've done such a good thing, and look at these activists, what's the matter with them? At that point, I had no other option except to go into city council with four caskets and shut down the city council unless they had an emergency session for this issue.
Wow.
So
on that same note, I know that at one point in time he was a former chair of Multnomah County.
Yes.
And was very familiar, because that was an issue that I was talking to in regards when I was running for mayor, was open up Wapato. Regardless, it's there, it we own it. It's open, it's clean, the whole nine yard. Why couldn't they open it up? Why was this an issue?
Deborah Kefauri has put the stops on that. The present chairperson on the commission has put the stops to it. Loretta Smith wants to do it. Right? And I think she's right. One of the things that we sit in front of the city council with a calendar, and it started from the day you brought
the coffins,
the symbolic coffins in. Next Wednesday will be 42 days. And what we're asking, Individuals for Justice is demanding that the city and the county, and we're also doing it at the county, just come up with a plan.
Yeah.
And that's what we're saying to them. You have an earthquake plan. You can go to your library and pull it out.
Mm-hmm.
Get a plan, like Mimi says, who do you call?
Mm-hmm.
What's the phone numbers?
Mm-hmm.
Why not TriMet? Get some heating buses going. Mm-hmm. Could we do that? This is the time to negotiate with TriMet, mm-hmm. not in January or February mm-hmm. when we're all freezing.
Mm-hmm.
Just show us the plan.
Well, what about these plans?
And they can't.
They claim they have plans.
Right. I'll tell you the plan.
Oh, they don't have a plan.
The plan that they have right now for weather emergency is a phone number, which is 211. Which is supposed to get you the help that you need if you are interested in locating a shelter.
Mm-hmm.
But when you speak to the people on 211 during the emergency, because I did, I called all the time, you know, and we had chaos in St. John's, except through the chaos, we at least had this back and forth between two churches that were really at mm-hmm. least trying to do something, right? And I knew what was going on. I called 211 and I said, I want a list of what else is happening in North Portland.
Mm-hmm.
They couldn't even tell me. They didn't even know the churches were open. They didn't even know which church was open. They didn't know. There was such mass confusion when I called. All I have is my perspective, okay? They tell me to call, I'm going to call. What, you know, you're giving me a plan, I'm going to try it out and see if it works. Then, so 211 was chaos, so completely ineffective. And I heard from staffers that unless people from different shelters call 211 to let them know what's going on in any given moment, the info that you're getting from 211 is old info, okay? And they're still using 211, just call 211. We could call 211 right now and get bad info. I can guarantee that. But, okay, so that's one thing. But the other part of the plan was that they were going to get people. With what? The cops, and we know this from people who have actually now testified to Ted, at City Hall. The cops sat in their cars watching people like me and my friends who were out in different parts of the community, helping people on the streets, passing out blankets, bringing soup, bringing coffee, making sure they were okay, batteries, sanitary needs,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
The cops sat there in their warm cars and never got out, never did a thing, didn't do a thing. And what did Ted do when he was approached by this? He said, the cops are busy doing things. They're busy. They're doing. Hmm. We're seeing them not doing.
And then they did a photo op with the fire department.
Right.
Well, you know, I'm leading up to something, and the whole idea is that I'm leading up to this, the latest piece in the mayor's office, and, well, the commission, they're just as responsible also, too, is the whole issue of the policy was just this past Wednesday, the exclusionary deal. They voted on this item, right? What does that mean? What is it? Define the exclusionary.
Well, let me explain why the exclusion ordinance became.
Right.
The exclusion became a thing because every week that what I was bringing forward as a citizen to complain about, which were all three things were emergencies. One was lack of shelters during weather emergencies. At the same time, what ended up happening was cop brutality took off mm-hmm. because we had Trump protests mm-hmm. and then protests after that and not my president's protest. Mm-hmm. And our cops went crazy. They went ballistic on people with the riot gear, and they beat people up. They arrested kids. They smashed Peggy, who's 62 years old. They smashed her face into the sidewalk. And on top of all that, as if that's not enough, the cops went after Teresa Rayford on the streets with the LRAD unit, calling her name out like the KKK. I'm hearing this. I'm out there hearing this. Teresa Rayford, if we see you, we will arrest you on the spot. And this
is a repeated
loop on this huge mega war machine that we have now in our city, on our streets during protests, right? Mm. And all I could think of was I'm seeing the KKK in my mind on horses coming through communities that are black communities, calling people out and ready to hang them. Mm. And Ted, after that was done, said, mistakes were made. That was a mistake about all of this. Hmm. So, and then the final thing that happened was Quanis Hayes was killed. And they made up a story about a gun. And they made up a story that he was a gang member. And they made up these stories the way they do. So I kept going back on Wednesdays. I kept going back to say, people are dying. When people die and people are getting brutalized, what's the most important thing for the city to do? It's to deal with that. Mm-hmm. Nothing else should be talked about until that is served, mm-hmm. you know, and that's fixed. Mm-hmm. So, not being heard, I continued 6 times in city council to turn the council into an emergency session. Mm-hmm. That's what I chose to do. Mm-hmm. And people supported me in that. They came with me, and we did this as a bunch of unified people mm-hmm. with a lot of mm-hmm. anger and sadness and frustration that our city's doing nothing. Mm-hmm. And in turn, what ended up happening was an exclusionary ordinance, which is unconstitutional because our friend Joe had already challenged that process with a previous mayor. Mm-hmm. And knowing that this was unconstitutional, knowing that the ACLU had written them to say this is an illegal act, you can't mm-hmm. do this, mm-hmm. they knowingly voted 5-0, verbally acknowledging that this was unconstitutional, for this to go through.
So all of them voted that way?
They all voted.
All of them voted that way. Originally,
and what about you?
Originally, it was set up as an emergency ordinance. But what they normally do on these, when things get hot in City Hall, they'll postpone the vote. They will not take the vote when all the activists are there and all the people are there and everybody's upset. They'll just say, no, we're going to put this over until next week. So they dropped it from the emergency ordinance to a normal ordinance, mm-hmm. and they said, let's do it next week. So they did it next week, and we went back next week, and we said to them, no, you cannot do this. It is totally illegal, all right? I know more about this than most people know about it, and the ACLU agrees with me. Here's what you cannot do. You cannot punish somebody for their behavior in one meeting to the next. So you can't say, well, you were bad over here, so we're going to exclude you from over here. You cannot do that. Mm-hmm. You can only say, okay, you were bad over here, you were bad over here, you're out of here. If I stand up and break protocol in the city council meeting and start yelling, they have a perfect right to say, sit down. Mm-hmm. And if I don't, they can say, get out. Mm-hmm. And
actually,
if I don't, they can have me arrested.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Those are the protocols.
Okay.
Like, pretty powerful stuff.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
What they want to do is this. After all of that, you're arrested, put in jail. They're going to say, well, Mr. Walsh, in the last year, we see that you've done this before. Therefore, you are not allowed in any city hall, any city building, anywhere.
What?
That means you cannot go to any city building.
No. Those are public facilities.
Yes,
that's right.
Are.
And the mayor, in his interview, said, I'm not sure this is constitutional. We'll let the federal judge decide. What kind of legislation is that? And they voted 5-0. Fisher's a lawyer. He's a labor lawyer. And he voted for it. And he bragged about it in his site. Said, it was a good week. We got the exclusion passed.
What about the city lawyer? We got a city attorney. Right?
We got 40 of them.
That sits right there.
They are telling this. They're telling the mayor and city council that there's a chance that this can be constitutional.
Yeah, but the chance in voting on something, that's a whole different ballgame. The idea is you go out and find out whether or not there is a solution, and they can do that. Then they can come back.
Right.
And do it.
So,
but this way here, you're
saying... The ACLU offered them to sit down and run some stuff by them to make it reasonable.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm not sure what the ACLU had in mind, but they did make the statement, you cannot punish somebody twice. And that's what you would be doing.
Okay.
You're punishing them once when you threw they're out and or put them in jail.
Mm-hmm.
That's one punishment.
Mm-hmm.
Second punishment is the mayor sits in his office and says, I don't like Joe Walsh.
Mm-hmm.
60 days.
Mm-hmm.
He can't even go in to the Portland building because it's part of the city property.
Mm-hmm.
Can't go into a hearing officer. And the topper, when I was reading the 17 pages that they gave us 3 minutes to comment on, under G, they say, you can go to a hearing officer that we pay and have your appeal.
Mm-hmm.
However, the presiding official, which is the mayor, and any of the city council members will not be called as witnesses for any reason. They immune themselves. That's kind of cool.
Mm-hmm.
Next time I go get a coffee, I'm going to immune myself. I don't have to pay for it.
Jeez.
And they said they think that's going to pass muster. Mm-hmm. Monday, I will file a motion. Here it is, right
this Monday.
This Monday. Basically saying to Judge Michael Simon, I want
you... He's federal or state?
Federal.
He's federal, okay.
He's a federal judge that came down with the original decision.
Okay.
He has jurisdiction. So I'm going back to him and saying, this is contempt of your order. I want them held in contempt. Now, all the lawyers that are listening to this, their ears just went straight out because if the judge finds them in contempt, he could arrest them. He could send the marshals in and arrest them. It's not going to happen.
You're talking about the city council and the mayor?
That's right. All of them. They're in contempt. And if you're in contempt of a federal judge, you can go to jail.
And they're knowingly in contempt.
And the mayor said, I know I'm in contempt.
Well, now, better go back for the benefit of the audience out here. You went to him initially, right, about
yes.
this issue.
What happened was I was excluded for 30 days.
You were, okay.
So I
when
stood
was
out.
This? About when?
Oh, this was 2014. The end.
Okay. Wow.
In 2015, they excluded me for 30 days
from the city council.
From the city council. So I went through their protocol and got the hearing officer that set up a hearing, and I called the mayor and a couple of the council people. That's what this is about. And the hearing officer said, okay, you're right. You have justification for calling them? We'll call them. They came back and they got a delay. And then they came back the third time and said, it's a moot question because the 30 days are already up. So Mr. Walsh has no standing anymore. And the hearing officer said, they're right. It's a moot question. And my appeal was poof. So I walked over and I said, okay. So then they did it again, 30 days again. And I didn't appeal that one. Then they did 60. And I said, they're on their way to permanent exclusion. All right, because they already had exclude one guy permanently. I said, permanently? You mean for the rest of your life or the rest of the mayor's life? Mm-hmm. Or what does permanently mean? Mm-hmm. So I went over to the federal courthouse and I said to the federal court system, I want three things. I want to do this pro se, do it on my own. I want you to waive all of the fees because they're expensive. They're about $1,000 federal. Mm-hmm. And then I want you to take jurisdiction because there was a question about jurisdiction. I go home and I get this phone call and it's from the clerk, from Judge Michael Simon, who was assigned, says we're going to set up a conference call. We're going to do oral arguments. And I said, well, did you give me the other two? Because I don't have any money. And they said, yeah, we gave you the other two too. We're going to waive all the fees and we're going to allow you to do it pro se. So I said, okay. So I went into court. Oral arguments. They sent two city attorneys over to argue against me. $100,000 city attorneys. They were sitting at the table. I was sitting all by myself.
No representation on your end?
No, I was doing
no
the pro se.
No court appointed or nothing like that?
Oh, I could have had a court.
Okay.
Probably could have gotten one, but I wanted to do it by myself.
Okay.
So I went up to the clerk and I said, hey, you know, there's two of them over there and me over here. So I said, I want a second chair. Second chair is another lawyer. So she said, okay. So she went in and asked the judge came out and said, yeah, go ahead, have a second chair. So I got my wife. And she said, come on up, sit at the counsel table. She said, what am I going to do? So I said, just shuffle papers. And she's watching this. She's laughing now. Just like this. Right? We argued the case. I think it was day before Christmas Eve, maybe the 23rd of December. I go home, Patty's got two glasses of wine on the cocktail table, which is really unusual. So I said, what happened? So she says, you won the case. Permanent injunction, not a temporary injunction, a permanent injunction. And they have to throw out their entire code of conduct. Wow. So that's what this is. A new code of conduct is more draconian than the original one. The original one didn't have some of that other crap in there.
Now, when that came out, well, the mayor then was Sam Adams.
Yes. Mm-hmm. No. Hales. The mayor was...
I'm sorry.
Hales. Yeah, Hales. Yeah, it was Hales.
Forget about him.
That's okay. I've been confusing Hales with Wheeler.
I've been through so many mayors
okay,
now.
Hales. Yeah. Okay. Okay.
No, it was Hales. It was Charlie Hales.
So Charlie was there. Was there an effort by him or his staff to contact you to sit down and chat with you about this issue?
No, they argued about appealing it to the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals, which was great on my part.
Right.
Because I said to Nick Fish, okay, I'm really popular in one state. Why don't you make me popular in nine states? Because if you think the Ninth Circuit's going to overturn this judge, you're out of your mind. He wrote a 23-page decision on one concept. Does the mayor have the right to sit in his office and say 60 days? Does he have that right? And the judge said no.
Well, recognizing this, they still went through this process this past Wednesday.
They're doing it again. Just like, think about this. Trump did the same thing. He turned around and said, you're banned from coming into the United States. Okay? And the federal court said, you can't do that. He said, okay. So they put an injunction on him. So he had to stop it. So what did he do? He wrote another one that's the same stuff. And he's putting it out. Now he's got more judges saying, stop it. That's what these guys are doing. They're doing the same thing. And they're insulting the judge by saying, tell us what we're doing wrong.
That's what he said.
Tell us what we're doing. No, the mayor is saying to the judge.
Ted Wheeler.
He said.
Tell us what we're doing wrong.
He said, we're going to do this.
In a public setting.
Yes.
Yeah, he said it to the newspapers.
You can tell me what we're doing wrong. As though he's going to elicit advice from a judge who already, first of all, ruled in favor of Joe on this, of which they're in contempt. And they've already passed this knowing it was unconstitutional. But what? They want advice from a judge.
He actually said, I am not going to enforce the exclusion part of this code of conduct until the judge rules.
As
he actually said that.
As if that makes everything else okay as well. He's saying that so that we don't freak out, we the activists who are there more often than not. So don't worry, kids. I'm not going to enforce it until a judge tells me if I can. But we're going to pass it.
Pass it 5-0.
Well, now let me ask you this other question. I take it the media was there.
The media was there.
Yes.
Now, did they approach you guys? They should have had all this information, right? That was one piece, right?
They approached the ACLU. They approached Matt Dos Santos because Chloe lied.
Chloe Udaly lied.
Right before the vote, Chloe gave this just patronizing speech about why she's going to vote for this. And after telling us that we were... Oh, this, that, and the other thing. Rude.
Yeah, we were interrupting her important work at the council to get the other council members on her side. So, and she can't do everything all at once.
Right. So
we
didn't
ask her anything.
So after telling us about us as, you know, being a mommy to us and not taking this seriously, she then said that because the ACLU didn't talk to them, and didn't come forward to whatever they thought the ACLU was going to do, help them draft this, which wasn't ever going to be the case. And I know that directly, that that wasn't going to be the case. The ACLU is there to tell somebody if you're about to do something illegal, which they had done. But the lie was that Matt Dos Santos had specifically called the mayor's office. He wasn't here. The mayor knew he wouldn't be here. He was away. And he called on Tuesday when he knew that his plane wouldn't be able to get back to say, I won't be able to get back. Since you've taken the emergency status off of this ordinance, I can meet with you later this week.
Mm-hmm.
And the mayor said, no, we're going to vote for this on Wednesday. So Matt did try. He tried numerous times to make that happen. So Chloe felt the need to lie about that and then tell all of us who voted for her, screw you, I'm voting to keep you
did
out.
Did she hold any kind of a meeting with the group or with you all? And from the standpoint of saying, this is really why, I mean, spending more than the three or four, the prop kind of a deal.
No, what she told me during shutdown number 6 at City Council, that was the day I think you were there.
Right.
Everybody left except for me and a few other people. There were a couple of media people there and just like one or two others. And she came in and she asked if she could meet with me. Mayor Wheeler was at jury duty that day, so he wasn't around. And she said, can we talk? And I said, sure, have a seat. And she said, what are you going to do? What happens next here? And I said, well, I'm going to continue to sit here and until you decide to have an emergency session, or we're going to keep it shut down. And she said, so you're going to stay and have it shut down? And I said, yes, if you guys decide that you're going to come back in to... you know, call this to order again, I will make sure that if it's not an emergency session, it will be closed.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And she said, well, I'm concerned that you will be arrested. And I said, I'm not. And she said, why? She said, I don't want you to be arrested. I said, neither do I, but no one has used the protocol that's in place to have me leave.
Mm-hmm.
And until that person comes in here to tell me 3 times I need to leave, I will be sitting right here.
And then what did she do?
She said, okay. She said, I want to tell you that I am concerned. I'm very concerned that by this behavior, she felt that the city council was going to decide to make it impossible for us to even be in the room. She said something to that effect, letting me know then at shutdown 6 that this was sort of in the works without saying too much about it. I heard her. And I said, well, you know, you've got to do what you've got to do. I wish that you would just do your jobs and take care of houseless during weather emergencies. Tell the head of the police, who is the mayor, to stop police brutality, stop the police from coming out in riot gear, stop going after our leaders, and get an indictment for cops who kill kids on our streets. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I said, do your job.
Now, what about the media by this particular time? You know, I'm still going back to the media.
Sure.
And then, because the other media guys, you've got, I mean, it's video, too.
Right.
It's on the tube aspect. Yep. And, but the idea is whether or not people, they don't advertise it as much as they should. But the point I'm making is that you got all these venues aspect of it, and you're the source. All you're basically saying, hey, look, this is my issue. And you just want to get it to the table.
I want them to do something. Because it's actable. It's actionable.
Okay.
We gave them the whole solution for the houseless issue.
Okay.
All of what we said required almost no money. Almost no money.
Right,
basically
right,
gas money.
And then, of course,
paying for people to do the extra work, which I'm fine about paying, you know, as a taxpayer.
Right.
And the other issue, Ted is in charge of the cops.
Yeah.
It requires no money. It requires him to go on TV and say, from now on, you will not meet protesters in riot gear.
Yeah.
And stop brutality.
Right. And that's an issue we need to talk. We need to solve the problem. I mean, you've got a bunch of folks out here that are looking at the folks who are demonstrating and this, that, and the other, as stone, was it activists, or what's the other word that they know how to use?
You got three different levels.
I guess my point is that they're not looking at folks out there from the standpoint that they have issues. And the reason why they were elected was to solve those issues.
Right.
Not actually just basically say, well, no, I'm going to just do it myself, as opposed to listen to what you have to propose. And then once they've taken your thoughts, then the idea come back to you and say, this is, I think, how we're going to solve the issue.
Right.
What do you think? That type of deal.
Right.
One of the things that always confuses me is that the people that sit on the city council, all five of them, very bright people.
Yeah, right.
Okay? And I could never figure out why bright people do such stupid stuff. Right? If you know that the people that you represent do not feel that they have any influence on what your decisions are, then wouldn't a bright person look in the mirror and say, well, maybe I gotta tweak this a little bit, maybe I gotta change this a little bit. It's not just us.
Mm-hmm.
The auditor did a study that we talked about a little bit,
mm-hmm.
and the study shows that 80% of the population of Portland, this is the city auditor, not me,
mm-hmm.
80% of the population of Portland does not feel like they have influence on the city council. Mm-hmm. If that was me, and somebody did an audit on me, and they said 80% of the people hate you, Joe, I would look in the mirror say, wait, whoa.
Right.
I got to do something different here.
Right. Because in all due respect, that's what they're looking at from the standpoint of the majority. That you are individuals. You don't really represent the issues.
But we do.
Yeah, I do.
You see, that's the point you just made about that 80%.
Mm-hmm. That's right. That's what people see. They see the activists.
Right.
Right. The activists, but they're sitting at home. And I asked my wife, because she watches the television. I think she's watching this. Did you understand what they were talking about? She said, no. Mm-hmm. She said, there's no information about the issue that they're voting on.
Mm-hmm.
And we keep telling them that. We keep extending our hand, and they keep chopping it off.
Mm-hmm.
And we say, why don't you explain more?
Mm-hmm.
I have to say that I am fair, and I believe in being fair.
Mm-hmm.
And Chloe did say to me that day, in that same conversation, that she also understands and finds it a very big problem that, and this isn't a quote, it's, you know, just kind of going back, reflecting on what she was saying, that there is an incredible lack of transparency in what is actually going on in back rooms to what we know in the front.
Yeah.
And she said it is a problem. She knows it's a problem. She sees that it's a problem. She even addressed that in between berating us during the exclusionary vote. She did address that. She told us that she basically made us all feel that we were unintelligent in the process, which wasn't called for or nice. But so at least Chloe Udaly knows that there is an incredible lack of transparency.
Yeah, but the
and
public
she,
knew.
Right. We've known that. And so the question again comes back to what are the actions that the city, which goes back to the beginning of the show, what is the city doing? But Ted, when Ted realized all this was going to keep happening, you know, during from the beginning, when I started in,
before he was elected,
he wasn't doing anything at that point, nothing, right? And then he said, after I think shutdown number two, it could have been number three, I think it was three. He said he'll meet with us outside if we allow city council to continue for the rest of that day. If we don't, he will not meet with us. So he felt threatened, so he threatened back. In the long run, we ended up allowing them to move forward and so that he would meet with us. It was at that point, talking to us, that he told us things that he also didn't follow through on. So now he came forward, he made that thing. He looked in the mirror, like, you know, Joe sang, and he was like, I better tweak this. But he didn't tweak it right. What he did was, I'm going to give them this crumb, so that I think that they'll be appeased.
Can you mention that specific crumb?
Yeah, there were a few. One was that he would meet with me.
Okay.
I had to shut down city council a few more times before that happened.
Okay.
Before that meeting would happen, because he was not going to meet with me. Mm-hmm. The other was that he would meet with members of the Black community, members of Don't Shoot Portland, and various other members.
The ministry.
That he would do that, and he hasn't done that. So to this date, he hasn't done that. He hasn't met by his hand. He hasn't called Don't Shoot Portland and said, let's meet. Mm-hmm. They forced the issue again on him, and they still haven't met. So Ted's tweak was, we'll give you this. We'll give you me. I'll talk to you. I'll tell you things that I'm pretty sure you want to hear. Mm-hmm. And you're going to be excited because you get to talk to the mayor. Mm-hmm. And in the beginning, for a moment, we were. Because we wanted to believe that Ted was a different guy, you know? And he's not a different guy. To date, I keep calling him Mayor Hales. Well, that's not intentionally,
I
forget.
Well,
some of the things we need to do, and I've been around a few days around this particular town, and I've been as frustrated as you are and whatever, but you learn things as you go. You know, I've run for office on several occasions, and my attitude is that I never said I'm going to stop, because I didn't win. No, I win every time I file.
Sure.
And I'm there serving that office while I'm running. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the day, if I'm not selected, boom, I just wait around again. But the point is that you talked about the Black community, meeting with the Black community. We have an issue in the Black community because there are so-called Black leaders, a few, not the majority of the community. Those are the ones that sign off. So a lot of times if a mayor's elected to office, that's right, there are two or three that they get, maybe none, they get monies under the table, you know, just monies or whatever, and they sign off. And so they represent the Black community. They don't represent me. Mm-hmm. See what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. But that's the problem that we have in the Black community, okay? And I'm sure that they have it in other communities. And in most cases, as you know, from a historical standpoint, the money, it's the old golden rule. He who has the gold rule, got me? And in most cases, they tend to run the whole show at City Hall. But things have changed. And that's what I'm saying. You know, we got rights, if you will. We're not thrown on the walls and getting shot and this, that, and the other. Things have changed, and so things are going to have to change.
Actually, kids are getting shot.
Yes. Well, I'm just saying to you. But things are changing. You know, it's not, we're not over there. We're here. You know what I'm saying?
The most encouraging thing for me, somebody has been doing this for a long time.
Right, Joe.
Is the young people that are coming up.
Yes, yes.
And us old guys.
Yes.
Got to get out of the way.
Yes.
And we got to say to the younger people, go ahead and do it and make your mistakes.
Yes.
All right, and not criticize them when they do it.
Right.
It drives me crazy when old fogies criticize the young people coming up because they're too militant.
Well, that's why we're doing the show, Joe.
Yes.
And that's why you and I are here, and that's why this young lady is
but
right
here. I preach that now, which is kind of hard looking in the mirror.
Yeah.
I realize I'm talking to myself.
Yeah.
You have to get
you
out of the
get
way.
Out. Yeah, that's right.
Because the young people that
they're not going to sit down and
they
negotiate.
They have their own answers.
Yeah.
And will they make mistakes? Sure, they'll make mistakes. Yeah, so what?
Yeah.
We're human. We're not gods.
Yeah, right. And you don't create.
And you learn. You learn.
You don't create unconstitutional ordinances to keep them out.
Well, this solution right now, let's talk again about the solution that's right there. Mm-hmm. What if I were to ask you, okay, fine, he's taking his position. Now you're voicing it, the rationale as to why you're here, and it hasn't been solved. Where do we go from here? What would you say to Ted Wheeler right now, the mayor and the city council folks? What do we say about this? I know you've said some other things, but do just maybe even if it's a matter of repeating yourself in regards to where you are now, but what would it take to get him at the table?
Well, I don't know what it would take to get him at the table, but I'd love for that to happen,
mm-hmm.
Because it needs to happen.
Right.
Because, mm-hmm. again, the houseless are suffering and dying in weather emergencies,
yeah,
and the weather
so,
emergencies
yeah.
aren't just snow.
Yeah.
It's massive rain, it's sleet, it's mm-hmm. cold.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that there was a moment when Ted was like, well, you know, if it's not under 32, we won't do anything. Who declares
yeah,
this?
He made this statement.
I'm not sure. I heard that he had. So it's I don't know if it's true or not. But for anyone to declare that anything above a certain temperature mm-hmm. that mm-hmm. we declare as like, you know, a freezing point
mm-hmm.
Is tolerable,
mm-hmm.
It's unconscionable.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So again, emergency for me at the top of the list are people on the street, are
mm-hmm.
most vulnerable.
Mm-hmm.
The other emergency is what the police are doing to
mm-hmm.
protesters,
mm-hmm.
to our freedoms,
mm-hmm.
to our black leaders,
mm-hmm.
and to killing kids
mm-hmm.
and getting away with it.
Mm-hmm.
Those things have to come to the table.
Mm-hmm.
They, the city council
mm-hmm.
or the mayor or
mm-hmm.
whoever among
mm-hmm.
them, but
mm-hmm.
not their staff,
mm-hmm.
needs to show up
mm-hmm.
with us
mm-hmm.
and tell us specifically, what are you going to do today?
Mm-hmm.
You better come with
mm-hmm.
answers
mm-hmm.
because we won't wait
mm-hmm.
one more day,
mm-hmm.
you know? Because the people who are getting brutalized, the kids who have been killed, they don't have one more day.
Mm-hmm.
The kids who are, the people who are sleeping, the man who died two or three nights ago in a tent
yeah.
and his dog, who I don't even know if his dog died yet or not. His dog is suffering.
No, the dog is okay.
That they don't have one more day.
Mm-hmm.
They don't have time to create a policy
mm-hmm.
when we've given them
mm-hmm.
such clarity,
mm-hmm.
such humane suggestions, such humane reality
mm-hmm.
of how humans help humans.
Mm-hmm.
And somebody said to me on Twitter today, I think that your expectation of Ted is actually insane, that he would go and could go and fix these things because he's one person. I said, he is not one person.
No.
He runs a city.
He runs a whole city.
He has a city that
he
can...
The buck stops there.
Exactly.
Yeah, the buck stops there.
And that needs to come to the table.
Right,
and
right.
What I would say to him, to any of them at the table is, first, you bring us, what are you going to do today?
Mm-hmm.
I want to know today. If you don't have anything for today, don't come to the table.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's no reason, but we'll see you in city council.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, again, another reason why I wanted to do this, and in fact, that's one of my rationale for running for mayor for the city of Portland. I saw this guy who first ran for county chair. He spent one term there. And then he went from there, he ran for treasurer.
Mm-hmm.
State treasurer.
Mm-hmm.
And then all of a sudden, he was going to run for governor. But that was a little bit too thick over there. He just didn't have the background. There were too many other, there were other activist political wills. Then he came over here and ran for mayor. So you ask yourself the question, well, gee, that to me would be a very powerful person. We would really get an asset.
Mm-hmm.
He's got all, he knew the, he went to the bank, had access to the bank.
Mm-hmm.
He had the county aspect
right.
of it, all the mental health stuff that we're
yep.
talking about,
mm-hmm.
and the Wapato stuff, all
mm-hmm.
that stuff would have been
mm-hmm.
taken care of. And then
yep.
now he's city of Portland aspect of, and he's from the city of Portland, got me? Very familiar with all of the stuff that you hear and this and that. And then the next thing, and then when he ran the campaign, he was taking his desk out and sitting on the street and talking to people
yep.
and talking to LGBT,
mm-hmm.
just
mm-hmm.
the whole nine yards. And now we're not getting anywhere. And then when I hear this piece, it's about he don't want to relate to blacks. I agree with you now. Now I understand.
Right.
I'm going to be coming at another way now. I'm going to be coming to the table since you've certified the fact. Now, I didn't want to say that, but it is a fact.
One of the really sad parts of what's going on
mm-hmm.
with all this stuff is we need each other.
Yeah.
As
yeah.
an activist,
yes.
I need the
yes.
mayor.
Yes.
Because
yeah.
what's coming down from the Trump administration, if you
mm-hmm.
just looked at the budget
mm-hmm.
that he put out,
mm-hmm.
is devastating.
Mm-hmm.
We need to stand together.
Yeah.
We keep putting our arms out
yeah.
and it's chopped off. I mean, I'm going to get my nickname
yeah.
Stumpy.
Yeah.
You know, because my arms are so
well,
stumpy.
Well, a lot of people are like that, are worse off than that.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
We
Business.
Keep saying to the
yeah.
mayor, look, we need you. We need Chloe. We need Fish. We need Thousand. We need
Well, all of them. That
Amanda.
Chair, all of them.
Well, that's all five of them.
All of them. Yeah.
Even though I don't like them.
Yeah, yeah.
And I say that to them. I don't like you, but I will stand next to you.
They got voted in. They're your leader.
That's yes. Because what's like coming down is worse than anything we've ever seen.
Yeah. I do think
and you can't exaggerate it.
I do think that there's something that's not being discussed yet.
Yes.
And I'm seeing it happen.
Okay.
And what I'm seeing from people responding to me who I don't know.
Okay.
So through Twitter, through comments from articles in the Oregonian, different things like
right,
this.
Right,
I read
right,
them because
right.
I want to get the pulse of what other people
right.
are thinking
right.
around those of us who are trying to get, mm-hmm. at least in this case,
mm-hmm.
these three issues dealt with,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
What are they hearing and how are they feeling?
Mm-hmm.
And it isn't good for us,
mm.
the people.
Mm.
What they're hearing is the reframing of what has happened
mm.
in city council.
Mm.
And that's because the mayor has the power with the media to reframe whatever he wants. And the reframing is dangerous.
Wow.
That is what Trump does.
Wow.
This mayor is not working for the most vulnerable.
Mm-hmm.
He's working like any other politician, including all five of them on city council, for the money, not for the people.
Well, let me suggest this, and we got to close now. We got about another minute. But let me suggest this. First off, let's invite the mayor. We'll invite the mayor to come to the table.
Oh, of course.
Okay, we'll invite the mayor and give him the opportunity, if you will, to respond, right? Is that fair? Okay?
Totally fair.
And then he's got the whole show. He can repeat it, the whole nine yards, and maybe he can come up with a package. But he needs to communicate to the public at large. This is not behind the scene. This is right to the public aspect of it. And I guess the other thing is that the media should be a part of the process. They got to communicate a bit better, if you will, because they're hearing what you're saying, but I'm not seeing that in the paper and in totality.
Media is not our friend.
I'm not seeing it. It's not seeing it that way. But that's their job. Okay, that's their job. That's why we're coming up with a whole new term now called fake news.
Mm-hmm.
You get me? And
sensationalizing.
Sensationalizing. That's right.
Right.
But we need that help, just like Joe was telling.
That's right.
We're going to be going. We're going in some dangerous waters right now, and every state's going to have to care for themselves, i.e., city and the whole nine yards. So we'd like to invite you, Mayor, to come on over to and do the show, whether it be with us, with them, or whether it would just be with me. But you got the video. You can look at it, and you can come back with your plan. And then the other thing I would suggest is that, in all due respect to you daily, Commissioner, she just got there. That was her platform, to represent the same folks that are talking right now.
That was a big vote.
And, you know, that was quite a deal, you know.
Vote.
But the bottom line, I'll invite her again. I've invited her a number of times, aspect of it. And so, and then the last thing I would say is that we will have another show next week. But we're not through. We're not through yet. We have to. We give the people the opportunity to see it. We'll share this. I'll make sure we get this out, aspect of it. If we got some time, you guys have some time. If they don't show up, we're going to show up.
So the invitation would be for them to join us next week.
To join us.
I'll be here.
And if they're not there, we'll just have the empty chairs and we'll just keep on going.
We'll talk to the empty chairs.
Is that okay? Well, folks, this has been just great. This is a start.
Thank
we
you.
Have to
Fast
start.
Hour.
Thank
okay?
you.
And please bear with us, folks. It is a government of the people, by the people, and for the people.
Mm-hmm.
And we want to work with our leaders because we elected them. Whether you like them or not, they still have a job to do. Okay, with that, thank you very, very much for being with us. And thank you, folks.
Thank
Appreciate
you.
It. Okay?
Thank you.
Have a good one. Always a pleasure.
That was terrific.
Okay, Jenna. Take care, folks. See you next time.